The candidates need no introduction. The Republican candidate, Vice President Richard M. Nixon, and the Democratic candidate, Senator John F. Kennedy. According to rules set by the candidates themselves, each man...
The Nixon-Kennedy debates would forever change the way Americans chose their presidents. Political rallies and old-fashioned handshaking became much less important than the image on the television screen.
You must understand that Nixon himself had said, I don't want any makeup on for these particular debates. What I tried to explain to Dick was he has a certain characteristics of his skin where it's almost transparent. And it was a very nice thought to say, I don't want any makeup, but that he really needed it in order to have what we would call even an acceptable television picture. And of course, JFK, here he'd been riding in motorcades all over California with the top down. He looked like a bronze warrior when he came into Chicago. He really did.
Mr. Nixon comes out of the Republican Party. He was nominated by it. And it is a fact that through most of these last 25 years, the Republican leadership has opposed federal aid for education, medical care for the aged.
I know what it means to be poor. I know what it means to see people who are unemployed. I know Senator Kennedy feels as deeply about these problems as I do. But our disagreement is not about the goals for America, but only about the means to reach those goals.
The first debate was costly to Nixon. The radio audience thought he had won, but the largest television audience in history had seen the vice president haggard and drawn, and had been given its first sustained look at the Kennedy style.
Kennedy had a great charm for not only the voters, but also for the press. The press corps had sort of a love affair with Jack Kennedy, and no matter what things we might do to make things better, we could serve a hot meal, they would serve a cold meal, and the press would like the cold better. He felt he was running up against impossible odds.
And I say we can't afford to have the White House as a training ground for an inexperienced man who is rash and impulsive.
This administration has failed to recognize, that in these changing times, with a revolution of rising expectations sweeping the globe, the United States has lost its image as a new, strong, vital, revolutionary society.
Election night, Nixon remembered, was the longest night of his life. It appeared at first to be a Kennedy sweep, then became too close to call, then edged back toward Kennedy again.
As I look at the board here, while there are still some results still to come in, if the present trend continues, if Mr. Kennedy, Senator Kennedy, will be the next president of the United States.
In the end, it proved to be one of the closest elections in history. Kennedy won by only 100,000 votes, and charges of Democratic fraud were widespread. Much of the winning margin came from Lyndon Johnson's Texas and Richard J. Daley's Chicago, but Nixon refused to demand a recount. If it failed to change the results, he wrote, charges of sore loser would follow me through history and remove any possibility of a further political career.
Richard Nixon is forever embittered by the experience and taken with the example. I think feels that never again will he be caught short, never again will his opponents outdo him, and never again will he trust the ordinary, normal, and honest devices of American politics to function as they're supposed to.
In his last official act as vice president, Nixon presided over a joint session of Congress on January 6, 1961. And announced his own defeat.
I now declare that John F. Kennedy has been elected President of the United States and Lyndon Johnson Vice President of the United States.
Come on, Dick. Enjoy sitting up here with you. I, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States and will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. So help me God.
As Nixon expected, President Johnson overwhelmed Republican Barry Goldwater in 1964, and the party lost disastrously in Congress. But in the ruins of that defeat, Nixon saw his way back to power. He worked the Republican congressional circuit tirelessly, traveled to 35 states, barnstormed for 105 candidates. And when the party made a dramatic comeback in 1966, there was hardly a Republican who didn't owe Nixon a favor.
He was uncomfortable with all of the obligatory activities of politics. Those were the dues one paid in order to gain admission to the arena. And he paid them. He flinched on occasion, but he paid them. He learned to do what he had to do.
How you doing, boy? Good to see you.
Nixon promised his family a moratorium on politics in 1967, but immediately took off on a grueling tour of four continents. Traveling as a private citizen, the former vice president could still command a crowd in the most remote reaches of the globe. His trips kept him in the news and strengthened his grasp of foreign policy. Once again, Richard Nixon was aiming for the presidency.
He had this absolutely core fire that he wanted to be president of the United States. I think for several reasons, probably to prove a lot of things to himself, but also because he sincerely wanted to take the country in a direction that he felt was the right direction.
As Nixon officially announced his candidacy in February 1968, the events of that tumultuous year moved him closer to the office he had sought for so long. In Vietnam, communist guerrillas fought their way to the very doorstep of the American embassy in Saigon. Never had the prospects for victory looked more bleak. At home, anger over the war tore the country apart and forced Lyndon Johnson to withdraw from the presidential race. Robert Kennedy was just beginning to emerge as the Democratic frontrunner when he was killed by an assassin's bullet. Race riots following the murder of Martin Luther King turned many cities into battlegrounds. The country had not suffered such upheaval since the Civil War. Many Americans yearned for a leader who promised safety and stability.
New Hampshire!
In Miami Beach, safe from the crises that engulfed the country, the Nixon family watched as Republicans chose their candidate.
For Richard M. Nixon.
There, we work for those.
Wisconsin is proud to cast its 30 votes for the nominee of this convention, Richard M. Nixon.
Sit down, get to work.
As he accepted the nomination of his party, Nixon offered himself as the man who could bring order out of the turmoil of 1968.
When the strongest nation in the world can be tied down for 4 years in a war in Vietnam with no end in sight, when the nation with the greatest tradition of the rule of law is plagued by unprecedented lawlessness, when a nation has been known for a century for equality of opportunity is torn by unprecedented racial violence, then it's time for new leadership for the United States of America.
Republicans once again pinned their presidential hopes on Richard Nixon. To them and to many in the press, he seemed a new Nixon, better prepared than the man who had lost in 1960. But the Democratic frontrunner Hubert Humphrey said he'd seen it all before.
They started the renewal job in 1952. Brand new Nixon. There was some reason for it, too. Then they had another renewal job in 1956. Then they had another renovation operation in 1960. Then when he went to run for governor in California in 1962, they renewed him again. And then in 1964, another touch-up. And now I read about the new Nixon of 1968. Ladies and gentlemen, anybody that had his political face lifted so many times can't be very new.
Boating in the Florida Keys, Nixon was relaxed and confident. He was running far ahead of Humphrey in the polls, and the Vietnam War was splintering the Democrats. At their convention in Chicago, the anti-war wing of the party pressed for an end to the bombing and a negotiated withdrawal of U.S. troops. But Humphrey stuck by President Johnson's policy.
And I think that withdrawal would be totally unrealistic and would be a catastrophe.
As the Democrats fought over Vietnam, Nixon avoided the issue, promising only that he would find an honorable end to the war. Along with millions of Americans, he watched on television as anti-war protests outside the convention hall exploded into violence. In the chaos, Nixon saw an opportunity. A few days later, he moved through the same streets in a motorcade. 400,000 people turned out to cheer him. He chose the city which had seen open war among the Democrats to sound one of the central themes of his campaign.
This is a nation of laws, and as Abraham Lincoln has said, no one is above the law, no one is below the law. And we're going to enforce the law, and Americans should remember that if we're going to have law and order.
The emphasis on law and order appealed to millions of Americans. Nixon's television commercials hammered it home.
In recent years, crime in this country has grown 9 times as fast as population. At the current rate, the crimes of violence in America will double by 1972. We cannot accept that kind of future for America. We owe it to the decent and law-abiding citizens of America to take the offensive against the criminal forces that threaten their peace and their security, and to rebuild respect for law across this country. I pledge to you the way...
To the Democrats, Nixon's call for law and order played to the worst in Americans.
But you can't vote your anger. You have to vote your hopes. You can't vote your hates. You have to vote your hopes. The preamble to the Constitution doesn't just say double the rate of convictions. It doesn't just say law and order. It says to ensure justice. And if Mr. Nixon hasn't read it, then I'll send him a copy.
But Nixon had a feel for the issues that moved the middle American voter. They were the same issues that moved him. Blaming liberal Democrats for the upheaval in the country, he sought to rally a new Republican majority.
A new voice that is being heard across America today. It is not the voice of a single person. It's the voice of a majority of Americans who have not been the protesters, who have not been the shouters. The great majority finally have become angry, not angry with hate, but angry, my friends, because they love America and they don't like what has been happening to America for the last 4 years.
You've just heard Richard Nixon refer to you, among all these other people, as the forgotten Americans. What do you think he's referring to?
Well, I sort of think he's talking about the people that are paying the taxes, that are supporting the schools, the churches, the people that are, they are sort of forgotten because everything's aimed at welfare and things like that.
Nixon's call to the forgotten Americans appealed to a broad band of voters, mostly white, middle class, hawkish, patriotic. It was a group that felt ignored and excluded in the upheavals of the 60s. And the strategy seemed to be working. Nixon held his strong lead into the fall. Then, just before the election, President Johnson suddenly stopped the bombing of North Vietnam. Humphrey surged in the polls.
We're going to have the biggest election surprise that America's known in 20 years. We're going to win this election. Thank you very much.
By election night, Nixon and Humphrey were dead even. Nixon prepared his family for the possibility of still another defeat.
You see that Nixon has closed a little bit in the last few tabulations there.
I think before the morning is out, Hubert Humphrey will be the next president of the United States.
And there have been no changes. None of those big states have fallen yet that we are the ones we are waiting for. And Nixon has 175.
All night long, the lead shifted back and forth. The results weren't announced until 8 the next morning.
With the 26 electoral votes in Illinois, Richard Nixon goes over the top with 287 electoral votes. He needed 270 to win, and that seems to be the 1968 election.
As Nixon took power, he assembled a staff that would leave him free to carry out his ambitious plans and whose loyalty had already been demonstrated.
The White House staff, as it evolves, I think you'll find will be smaller than it's been in the past.
H.R. Haldeman, a former advertising executive who had been at Nixon's side since 1956, was made chief of staff. He was proud, he once said, to be Richard Nixon's son of a bitch. John Ehrlichman, a lawyer and top aide during the campaign, would handle much of domestic policy. Together, he and Haldeman would tightly control access to the president. Those whom they excluded called them the Berlin Wall. Behind that wall, Nixon could focus on his main interest, foreign policy, bypassing the State Department to work closely with his national security advisor, Henry Kissinger.
Dr. Kissinger is perhaps one of the major scholars in America and the world today in this area. He has never yet had a full-time government assignment, and he will bring to this responsibility a fresh approach.
They organize the government to concentrate power in the hands of these two men in the White House. And it's not accidental that he appoints an old friend but a decidedly weak practitioner in Bill Rogers in the Department of State, or essentially a Wisconsin Dells politician, Melvin Laird, as Secretary of Defense. There are no strong figures in this cabinet, and there are no strong foreign policy figures anywhere in the higher echelons of the government. It is to be Richard Nixon's foreign policy, and it is to be carried out with sophistication and some subtlety by Henry Kissinger.
Looming over the new administration was the war in Vietnam. American troops had been fighting for 4 years on behalf of South Vietnam against the Soviet-backed communist forces of the North. The war had already taken the lives of 30,000 Americans and over 1 million Vietnamese, and destroyed one president. Nixon was determined not to let it destroy him. Even before his inauguration, Nixon had Kissinger begin secret contacts with the North Vietnamese in an attempt to move the stalled Paris peace talks forward. And soon the two men developed a strategy they hoped would get the U.S. out of the war without abandoning America's ally, South Vietnam.
We have adopted a plan which we have worked out in cooperation with the South Vietnamese for the complete withdrawal of all U.S. combat ground forces and their replacement by South Vietnamese forces on an orderly, scheduled timetable. This withdrawal will be made from strength.
Confident that this policy would end America's involvement in Southeast Asia by the end of 1970, Nixon and Kissinger turned their attention to global strategy, reshaping America's entire relationship with the communist world.
they both begin in 1969, 1970, with a notion that that only lately has become fashionable in Washington, and that is that the post-war is really over, that the Cold War ought to be a thing of the past. They are, in that sense, almost 20 years ahead of their time.
Recognizing that the Soviet Union had nearly caught up to the U.S. in nuclear strength, Nixon and Kissinger dispatched a team of negotiators to work out a treaty with the Soviets. For the first time in the history of the nuclear age, the two superpowers sat down to discuss setting limits on nuclear weapons. At the same time, they began secret contacts with the other great communist power, China. There were few more forbidding and isolated places in the world in 1969, but Nixon believed that China, with its vast population and growing nuclear arsenal, would soon be too powerful to ignore.
Here, for the first time in the 20th century, we have two men at the very pinnacle of the American government who have some clear notion, not only of what the world is doing out there, what's happening in the world, but of where they want the United States to fit in. We are not a nation that practices its foreign policy by design, for the most part. And Nixon and Kissinger are an exception to that rule.
In the summer of 1969, Nixon announced the first American troop withdrawals from Vietnam. Arms control, China, Southeast Asia. He seemed to be moving steadily toward becoming a peacemaker. Richard Nixon was determined not to be the first American president to lose a war. He might simply have brought the troops home and blamed Vietnam on the Democrats. But Nixon, like many of his contemporaries in both parties, believed that abandoning South Vietnam to the communists would be a defeat that invited further aggression, a sign that America could no longer be counted on by her allies. Despite mounting pressure for immediate withdrawal, he stuck to his gradual course while trying to negotiate what he called an honorable end to the war. But the months dragged on, casualties mounted, and Nixon's policy seemed only to prolong America's agony.
I said, with respect to Vietnam, I said, the war in Vietnam is lost. And the sooner you get out, the better we will be. It was lost, but he, for some reason, kept at it. It wasn't his war. And it seemed to me that just handling a presidency, you stick around with the war for 2 years and it's your war.
To you, the great silent majority of my fellow Americans, I ask for your support. For the more divided we are at home, the less likely the enemy is to negotiate at Paris. Let us be united for peace. Let us also be united against defeat. Because let us understand, North Vietnam cannot defeat or humiliate the United States. Only Americans can do that.
It was the most effective speech of Nixon's presidency. 80,000 telegrams and letters arrived at the White House. Nearly all supported him. His approval rating soared. But the war continued, and with it the protests.
I think Richard Nixon came to office expecting, if not a quick fix in Vietnam, expecting a kind of responsiveness in the war. He had made certain speeches, he had offered certain gestures, he had proffered both secretly and publicly what he thought were promising initiatives in negotiations. None of that had yielded anything. There was a palpable sense of frustration in the administration about how long this war was going to drag on.
After three tense days of demonstrations at Kent State University in Ohio, nervous National Guardsmen opened fire. Four students were killed, My child was not a bum, said the father of one dead girl. American campuses exploded. Hundreds of colleges and universities closed down. Governors in 16 states called out the police and National Guard. Nixon's supporters took to the streets as well. At New York City Hall, construction workers struggled to raise the flag which the mayor had lowered to honor the dead at Kent State. Nixon's move into Cambodia and his dividing of Americans into bums and heroes had set off a national firestorm. Angry protesters returned to Washington. As tensions rose, the Secret Service ringed the White House with a barricade of buses.
It was like living in a bunker in the White House. I mean, you'd look out in the streets and see thousands of people protesting. You literally were afraid for your life. There were times when I can remember saying, I can't believe this is the United States of America, a free country. And here we are in the White House with barricades up and buses around the White House and tear gas going off and thousands, hundreds of thousands of protesters out in the streets and troops sitting here.
An embattled Nixon faced the press as anti-war demonstrators continued to flock to Washington.
Capitol.
What do you think the students are trying to say in this demonstration?
They're trying to say that they want peace. They're trying to say that they want to stop the killing. They're trying to say that they want to end the draft. They're trying to say that we ought to get out of Vietnam. I agree with everything that they're trying to accomplish.
In the left corner was an account of Trisha's wedding. Across the page was another headline. The first installment of what came to be called the Pentagon Papers, a secret Defense Department study which revealed past government deception about the war in Vietnam. Daniel Ellsberg, a former Defense Department employee who had turned against the war, had given the top secret documents to the press.
I can no longer cooperate in concealing this information from the American public.
Although the Pentagon Papers contained nothing about the Nixon policy in Vietnam, it was a leak of enormous magnitude. The president and Henry Kissinger saw it as a disturbing precedent and a threat to their secret diplomacy.
There was panic in the White House. And I remember being in meetings with Henry Kissinger that day in which he said this could cause the collapse of American foreign policy. This could undermine our initiatives with China and the Soviet Union. And don't forget that at that time, people did not know that we were negotiating secretly with the Chinese. They did not also know that we were conducting secret negotiations with the North Vietnamese to end the war in Vietnam. And so a lot of things were going on that we knew that the public didn't.
Just 5 weeks later, the Times published another leak, this one potentially damaging to Nixon's foreign policy. It revealed U.S. negotiating tactics in upcoming arms talks with the Soviets, and it seemed to confirm Nixon's worst fears about the press.
I had seen him angry in meetings in the past, but I had never experienced this kind of fury, where he was basically walking around the room, slamming his fist in his hand, saying that this cannot be tolerated. We cannot let this go on.
Nixon became obsessive about the press coverage.
In this atmosphere of us versus them, Colson's office began an ever-expanding list of Nixon's critics, the enemies list. Its object was to screw our political enemies. Reporters and politicians, educators and entertainers were barred from the White House. Some were targeted for tax audits. Others were trailed by private detectives.
And it was very shortly thereafter that Nixon authorized the plumbers, the creation of a special group to stop leaks, and they began to take extra legal steps and put into motion the mechanism which ultimately resulted in the downfall of the administration.
In a White House memo regarding the neutralization of Daniel Ellsberg, the plumbers discussed how they might destroy his public image and credibility. In search of damaging information about Ellsberg's private life, they arranged a break-in at the office of his psychiatrist.
they apparently broke a window on the way in, and realizing that it could no longer be viewed as a covert operation, changed courses and decided to make it look as if it had been entered by a burglar looking for drugs or some other substances. Basically, they smashed up the office, took pictures of the damage. I was shocked at these pictures. Went to see John Ehrlichman. He was, if anything, more shocked than I was, and said, shut it down as of now.
The Plumbers were eventually disbanded, but some of the agents were reassigned to work behind the scenes for the newly formed committee to re-elect the president. Re-election had become Nixon's consuming concern. From the first day of his presidency, he had fought to hold on to his silent majority and had shaped his domestic policies in part to win their votes. But those voters were slipping away. Unemployment and inflation were up. Racial divisions had deepened. And still, week after week, the dead came home from Vietnam. Nixon's popularity had fallen so low that he had begun to fear he would not even be renominated in 1972.
The 37th President of the United States, Richard M. Nixon, is in China, the first American chief executive ever to visit the world's most populous country.
On February 18th, 1972, Richard Nixon began still another remarkable comeback with a stunning foreign policy success.
President Nixon's motorcade is now sweeping toward the city of Peking.
Here comes the motorcade now, as you see.
The world watched as Richard Nixon drove through a city that few outsiders had seen for nearly a quarter of a century. He knew, said the New York Times, that for this journey, no matter what else occurred, he would always be remembered. That afternoon, Nixon was abruptly summoned to see Mao Zedong. American television was unaware of the meeting. The only coverage was by Chinese cameramen with black and white film. This encounter between Nixon, the career anti-communist, and Chairman Mao, the leader of the largest communist revolutionary movement in history, shocked Nixon's old conservative allies. They accused him of surrendering to international communism. But for Nixon, it was all part of his global strategy. By visiting China, he was beginning to exploit the divisions in the communist world.
One of Nixon's primary objectives in opening up with China was to give him more leverage with the Soviet Union. These relations were essentially stalled, but soon after the opening with China, the Soviet Union became much more flexible in several fronts. They agreed to a summit meeting with us in 1972, and they began to be more reasonable on various arms control issues.
Nixon enjoyed the power game, probably as much as any president in modern times. He played it very hard and very cleverly and very carefully in the world scene. And he was always thinking strategically, and that's one of the qualities that someone has to have in foreign policy. I mean, you cannot make decisions in foreign policy based on today's circumstance. You've got to think about its ramifications for 5, 10, 15, 20 years down the road. It's like a chess player. You're anticipating six moves ahead if you're a good chess player.
On May 22, 1972, Richard Nixon became the first American president ever to set foot inside the Kremlin. Nixon had done what none of his predecessors had been able to do. he had negotiated a treaty in which the two superpowers agreed to slow an arms race that had been accelerating for more than a quarter of a century. It was his greatest achievement. Two days later, five burglars working for the committee to re-elect Richard Nixon entered the Watergate complex in Washington. They broke into the office of the Democratic National Committee, placed bugs on the telephones, and made their escape. But the microphones failed to work. They would have to go back.
The President of the United States.
Nixon returned from Moscow in triumph. He had almost completed the withdrawal of American forces from Vietnam, opened the door to China, and signed the first nuclear arms limitation treaty since the dawn of the atomic age. He had often said that all he wanted was a life with one more victory than defeat. Now that victory, a second term as president, seemed his for the asking.
Five men wearing white gloves and carrying cameras were caught early today in the headquarters of the Democratic National Committee in Washington. They apparently were unarmed, and nobody knows yet why they were there. But I don't think that's the last we're going to hear of this story.
Nixon's campaign amassed huge sums of money. Skillful television ads appealed to Democrats, blue-collar workers, the South. Nixon had always campaigned hard for other Republicans. Now he abandoned them, even dropped the party label. Richard Nixon campaigned as the president.
You're great.
Thank you. Well, you're great. Hi.
As the president pursued victory, the White House continued to deny involvement in Watergate. A few reporters followed the story, but most voters dismissed the break-in as a campaign caper. Watergate never threatened Nixon's big win. Nixon overwhelmed his Democratic rival, Senator George McGovern. He carried every state but Massachusetts. But his victory was not complete. The Democratic opposition retained control of both the House and the Senate.
It turned out to be a lonely landslide. He monopolized all of the resources, all of the money, all of the political talent in the Republican Party and anything else that he could annex for his own personal victory and didn't share the wealth and the opportunity with his party. It was an extraordinarily selfish victory, in my view.
We are showing President Nixon at this hour.
On election night, Nixon watched the returns with two of his closest aides, Chief of Staff H.R. Haldeman and Special Counsel Chuck Colson.
And I couldn't feel any sense of jubilation. It was just sort of a very depressed atmosphere in the room. And here we were supposedly winning, and it was more like we'd lost. And it was more, the attitude was kind of, well, we showed them we got even with our enemies and we beat them. Instead of, we've been given a wonderful mandate to rule over the next 4 years, we were reduced to our petty worst on the night of what should have been our greatest triumph. And that's indicative of kind of the paradox of the Nixon years.
The bombing stopped, the controversy subsided, and shortly thereafter, all sides returned to Paris. Nixon believed the Christmas bombing had driven Hanoi back to the bargaining table. 2 weeks later, in a quiet ceremony, they signed an agreement. Nixon's critics charged he could have had the same terms months before. But after 20 years of American involvement, the loss of over 50,000 American lives, the conflict that had torn apart the nation, at long last, came to a close.
A ceasefire will begin at 7 p.m. this Saturday, January 27, Washington time. Within 60 days from this Saturday, all Americans held prisoners of war throughout Indochina will be released. During the same 60-day period, all American forces will be withdrawn from South Vietnam.
In Vietnam, the fighting later resumed, but in America, the weary troops and the prisoners of war were finally coming home.
I have three words for America. God bless America.
H.R. Haldeman recalled that the day the war ended, Richard Nixon had never looked so happy. His popularity soared to the highest point of his entire career. Almost 70% of the American people supported the president. It was not to last. One month before the Watergate burglars went on trial, a 737 crashed in Chicago. Among the dead was Dorothy Hunt, wife of Watergate burglar Howard Hunt. Her purse, found in the wreckage, contained $10,000 in cash. Later, it would be revealed that Mrs. Hunt had acted as a courier, delivering money drawn from secret White House funds. Hush money, used to buy the burglars' silence. From the moment they were caught, the burglars lied to conceal their ties to the White House. Questioned by the FBI, G. Gordon Liddy, who'd planned the burglary, and James McCord, former CIA agent who'd helped to carry it out, insisted they had acted on their own. So did the president's men. Nixon's campaign manager and former Attorney General John Mitchell, who had approved the break-in, denied responsibility. The president's chief of staff, H.R. Haldeman, authorized hush money payments totaling more than $350,000. The president's domestic advisor, John Ehrlichman, lied to the FBI and grand jury investigating the break-in. The president's counsel, John Dean, withheld evidence, coached witnesses, and monitored the FBI investigation. The cover-up was holding, but by early 73, it was consuming the time and attention of Nixon's closest aides, Haldeman and Ehrlichman. By February, John Dean had assumed more responsibility for managing the cover-up. He began to meet frequently with the president.
When I first started dealing with the president, my first concern was whether I should even be dealing with him on this, because I felt that not only had I been compromised, I thought Haldeman, Ehrlichman, Mitchell, all of us had, because by now I didn't have to be a criminal lawyer. I knew we were in the midst of something bad. I mean, this is a cover-up. There is no doubt in my mind.
Nixon noted in his diary, "I'm glad that I'm talking to Dean now rather than going through Haldeman or Ehrlichman. I think I've made a mistake in going through others when there is a man with the capability of Dean I can talk to directly." Both Nixon and Dean sensed growing danger from Capitol Hill. The Senate, under Democratic leadership, was forming a special Watergate committee to investigate the break-in and the conduct of Nixon's re-election campaign. But the most immediate threat came from Watergate burglar Howard Hunt. Despairing over the death of his wife, concerned over the fate of his children, he now demanded $120,000. Or he would reveal, he said, the seamy things he had done for the Nixon White House.
This is the first time one of these threats had ever been brought directly to me, and I didn't like being in that role, because I knew about the money out there, but I'd never been a conveyor of messages back and forth. And now suddenly I'm just right in the middle of another ugly side of this.
Hunt's demand was a turning point for John Dean. The White House could no longer control the cover-up. On March 21st, a worried Dean tried to persuade Nixon to end the conspiracy. He described the cover-up as a cancer on the presidency and warned that Haldeman, Ehrlichman, and Dean himself had broken the law.
And the president started knocking down every one of these horribles I kept raising. Finally, I got around to saying, well, you know, these guys want a lot more money and to remain quiet. It's just, you know, no telling how much they want. And he said, well, how much could they want? And I pulled out of thin air what I thought was a pretty astronomical number. I said, well, it could cost $1 million. Well, he looked at me and he said, well, John, I know where we can get $1 million.
Nixon approved more hush money. He let the cover-up continue. 2 days later, the cover-up blew wide open.
Good evening. There was a major break in the Watergate trial today. On this day of sentencing, one of the defendants, James McCord, promised to reveal hidden details about the bugging of the Democratic headquarters.
In a letter to the judge presiding at the trial, James McCord admitted that the Watergate burglars had not acted on their own. His testimony implicated the White House and galvanized the national press. Even before McCord's letter, Nixon had ordered John Dean to write a report that would exonerate the White House of wrongdoing.
The president asked him to reduce his understanding of the whole problem to writing. He asked him to do that 4 or 5 times. And nothing happened. And finally, the president sent John Dean to Camp David in the middle of March to sit down, do nothing, but write a report for the president on what this Watergate business was all about, who was involved, who was at fault, all of that. While Dean was up there, he had an epiphany, which was that he was in deep trouble, or so he says.
Well, it was clear, it was much clearer after the fact, but I suspected at the time I was being set up. And the whole plan was to give the president this report so he could say, this is all I've ever known. And my counsel lied to me, clearly. And I just wasn't a part of that.
The cover-up was disintegrating, and Dean feared that he might become Nixon's scapegoat. In early April, he telephoned Haldeman to say that he was talking with the prosecutors. Haldeman cautioned him, I think you ought to think about it. Because once the toothpaste is out of the tube, it's hard to get it back in. If Dean is totally out of control, Ehrlichman told Nixon, you could get an article of impeachment. Haldeman later remembered that Nixon looked stunned. In private, the president continued to search for a scapegoat and struggled to salvage the cover-up. In public, he acted as if he were upholding the law.
I can report today that there have been major developments in the case concerning which it would be improper to be more specific now, except to say that real progress has been made in finding the truth. I condemn any attempts to cover up in this case, no matter who is involved. Thank you.
Events were spinning out of Nixon's control. John Dean, bargaining for immunity with Watergate prosecutor Earl Silbert, made a stunning revelation.
Dean's lawyer said, Dean has one more thing to tell you that you might want to know about. And Dean at that point said, we are standing in the hallway and Dean is in the office. He said, in substance, that Liddy and Hunt were involved in a break-in into the office of Ellsberg's psychiatrist, Dan Ellsberg's psychiatrist. I know my jaw must have fallen down to the floor. I mean, that was a bombshell of information.
The Senate Watergate Committee began hearings that would keep the nation spellbound throughout the summer.
The historic caucus room was jammed today with cameras, newsmen, 200 seated spectators, and more standing. This room has been the scene of...
One of the largest audiences in television history watched on May 17th as Senator Sam Ervin opened the investigation of Nixon's re-election campaign and the Watergate break-in.
The committee will come to order. The questions that have been...
Even the president's staff watched as a parade of witnesses implicated Haldeman, Ehrlichman, and others high in the administration and the Nixon campaign. But in the first month of testimony, the president himself escaped direct charges of wrongdoing. Then the committee summoned its star witness, John Dean. In a 7-hour opening statement, Dean described the atmosphere of the Nixon White House.
The Watergate matter was an inevitable outgrowth of a climate of excessive concern over the political impact of demonstrators, excessive concern over leaks, an insatiable appetite for political intelligence, all coupled with a do-it-yourself White House staff, regardless of the law.
He spoke in almost a monotone as he began to tell some of the most outrageous stories about what had occurred. And coming from a monotone, it was the facts rather than his personality that came out at the public.
Dean described his meeting on March 21st when he warned Nixon about the burglars' escalating demands.
I told the president about the fact that there was no money to pay these individuals to meet their demands. He asked me how much it would cost. I told him I could only make an estimate that it might be as high as $1 million or more. He told me that that was no problem. He also looked over at Haldeman and repeated the same statement.
That story came out. It was the very first time in the hearings, the very first time any evidence came forward that really put the president in on the obstruction of justice. The president who said he knew nothing about these things. The president who said he had started an investigation to find out who was involved. And here was an eyewitness, a person who was involved, who was testifying to the president's very deep involvement in the obstruction of justice and the cover-up.
It was now the word of the president against his 34-year-old former counsel. The White House tried to undermine Dean's testimony by spreading rumors about his credibility and character. With no way to determine who was telling the truth, Nixon believed he would prevail. Then on July 16th, everything changed for Richard Nixon.
My name is Alexander Porter Butterfield.
Mr. Butterfield, are you aware of the installation of any listening devices in the Oval Office of the President?
I was aware of listening devices. Yes, sir.
And so that if either Mr. Dean, Mr. Haldeman, Mr. Ehrlichman, Mr. Colson had particular meetings in the Oval Office with the President on any particular dates that had been testified before this committee, there would be a tape recording with the President of that full conversation, would there not?
Yes, sir.
One last question. If one were, therefore, to reconstruct the conversations at any particular date, what would be the best way to reconstruct those conversations, Mr. Butterfield?
Well, in the obvious manner, Mr. Dash, to obtain the tape and play it.
I have no further questions, Mr. Chairman.
Nixon was in the hospital with viral pneumonia when he learned about Butterfield's testimony. He wrote on a bedside pad, "Should have destroyed the tapes after April 30th. Nixon knew controlling the tapes was the key to his survival. He would appeal to historical precedent and argue that the tapes were like presidential papers. They belonged to the president, not to Congress or the courts. The president had a right to keep them private. The events that followed became known as the Saturday Night Massacre.
Good evening. The country tonight is in the midst of what may be the most serious constitutional crisis in its history. The president has fired the special Watergate prosecutor, Archibald Cox. Because of the president's action, the attorney general has resigned. Elliot Richardson has quit, saying he cannot carry out Mr. Nixon's instructions. Richardson's deputy, William Ruckelshaus, has been fired. Ruckelshaus refused in a moment of constitutional drama to obey a presidential order to fire the special Watergate prosecutor. And half an hour after the special Watergate prosecutor had been fired, agents of the FBI, acting at the direction of the White House, sealed off the offices of the special prosecutor, the offices of the attorney general, and the offices of the deputy attorney general.
Six FBI agents present, impeding our operations right now.
All of this adds up to a totally unprecedented situation, a grave and profound crisis in which the president has set himself against his own attorney general and the Department of Justice. Nothing like this has ever happened before.
More than 50,000 telegrams poured in on Capitol Hill today. So many, Western Union was swamped. Most of them demanded impeaching Mr. Nixon.
These come from Republicans and businessmen and people, most of whom begin their statement by saying, I've supported the president, I've never believed in impeachment, but he's now gone too far, and we want the Congress to take strong action.
On Tuesday, Nixon learned that 21 resolutions calling for his impeachment had been introduced on Capitol Hill. Stunned by the ferocity of the public reaction, Nixon retreated. He appointed a new special prosecutor, Leon Jaworski, and agreed to release the 9 subpoenaed tapes. But 2 tapes turned out to be missing. The White House said they never existed. A 3rd tape contained an 18.5-minute gap. The erased section was a conversation between the president and H.R. Haldeman 3 days after the break-in.
And I want to say this to the television audience. I made my mistakes, but in all of my years of public life, I have never profited from public service. I've earned every cent. And in all of my years of public life, I have never obstructed justice. And I think, too, that I can say that in my years of public life, that I welcome this kind of examination, because people have got to know whether or not their president is a crook. Well, I'm not a crook. I've earned everything I've got.
On Capitol Hill, the House Judiciary Committee was debating Nixon's impeachment, investigating charges ranging from illegal wiretaps and break-ins to abuse of power and obstruction of justice. Pursuing their investigations, they demanded more tapes and set a deadline of April 30th. On April 29th, with less than 24 hours to go, facing a citation for contempt of Congress, Nixon tried to do again what had worked so well for him in the past, bypass his opponents and appeal directly to the public.
Good evening. I have asked for this time tonight in order to announce my answer to the House Judiciary Committee's subpoena for additional Watergate tapes. In these folders that you see over here on my left are more than 1,200 pages of transcripts of private conversations.
Nixon announced he was releasing edited transcripts of the tapes to the committee and the public simultaneously. The president himself had supervised the editing.
In giving you these records, blemishes and all, I am placing my trust in the basic fairness of the American people.
Nixon had gambled and lost. He badly misjudged the public reaction. The transcripts, said Time magazine, showed a president creating an environment of deceit and dishonesty, of evasion and cover-up. Even Republican leaders denounced them as shabby, disgusting, immoral. A majority of Americans now thought the president should resign or face impeachment. On Capitol Hill, the Judiciary Committee prepared to vote on 3 articles of impeachment. They charged the president with obstruction of justice, abuse of power, and contempt of Congress.
The thing that's so appalling to me is that the president, when this whole idea was suggested to him, didn't in righteous indignation rise up and say, get out of here, you're in the office of the president of the United States. How can you talk about blackmail and bribery and keeping witnesses silent? This is the presidency of the United States. But my president didn't do that. He sat there and he worked and worked to try to cover this thing up so it wouldn't come to light.
The committee took its first vote July 27th. Nixon was swimming at San Clemente as they rendered their verdict.
Signify by saying aye. All those opposed, no.
Mr. Flowers.
Aye.
Mr. Mann.
Aye.
Mr. Drynan.
Aye.
Nixon later wrote,
Mr. Rangel.
I was getting dressed in the beach trailer when the phone rang and Ziegler gave me the news. That was how I learned that I was the first president in 106 years to be recommended for impeachment. standing in the beach trailer, barefoot, wearing old trousers, a Banlon shirt, and a blue windbreaker emblazoned with the presidential seal.
No. Mr. Rodino.
Aye.
27 members have voted aye. 11 members have voted no.
And pursuant to the resolution, Article 1, that resolution is adopted and will be reported to the House.
Just days before, the Supreme Court had ruled in the case of the United States versus Richard Nixon. The president must turn over the tapes to the special prosecutor. Not even a president, said the court, could withhold evidence in a criminal trial. With nothing left to lose, he decided to release a transcript of the tape. It became known as the smoking gun. The night following the release of the transcript, Nixon sat alone in the Lincoln sitting room, then retired to bed. His daughter Julie had left a note on his pillow. The White House, August 6th. Dear Daddy, I love you. Whatever you do, I will support. I'm very proud of you. Go through the fire just a little bit longer. You're so strong. I love you. Millions support you. Julie. On August 8th, Nixon announced he would address the nation. Outside the White House, crowds gathered, watching, waiting.
I have never been a quitter. To leave office before my term is completed is abhorrent to every instinct in my body. But as president, I must put the interests of America first. Therefore, I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow. Vice President Ford will be sworn in as president at that hour in this office.
On August 9th, the president bid farewell to the White House staff.
You are here to say goodbye to us. And we don't have a good word for it in English. The best is au revoir. We'll see you again. Because the greatness comes not when things go always good for you, but the greatness comes and you're really tested when you take some knocks, some disappointments, when sadness comes. Because only if you've been in the deepest valley can you ever know how magnificent it is to be on the highest mountain. Always give your best. Never get discouraged. Never be petty. Always remember, others may hate you, but those who hate you don't win unless you hate them. And then you destroy yourself.
On September 8th, 1974, President Gerald Ford granted Richard Nixon a full and absolute pardon. Over 70 others were found guilty of criminal acts and punished. The contradictions of Nixon's career, his triumphs and defeats, grand vision and petty grievances, have left their imprint on America. But his legacy remains ambiguous. The judgment of history, Nixon has said, depends on who writes it.